So now, what I have shown you just now is Vidyasagar Setu. It's in India. It's in Hooghly, over Hooghly. Okay, it is a type of truss that you can see. Is it a truss? Is it a frame? Is it a machine? We'll formally define all those in this module. We'll see some examples and we'll formally come back to this. Okay, so let us start. Let us start the module and we'll take up queries one by one. Okay, if at all you have. Let me start first. Okay, so this module will have analysis of structure. Okay, analysis of structure, different types of structure which are specifically, as I have told, it will be truss, frames and machines. So trusses, they are designed to support loads. All members are two force members. Now you got it. A part of your answer is there now. Okay, so all members of a truss are two force members, like a cycle. No, if you consider any one element, it has got two forces, one over here, another one over here, right? So that is truss. Okay, frames, they are designed to support loads. They are designed to support loads. They consist of multi-force members. A single member can have force or forces from multiple directions. This also we'll see. This is only specific to frame. So there is not much difference when you see externally, until unless you analyze it thoroughly, you will see you both looks like very much the same. Okay. So machines are designed to transmit or modify forces. Transmit or modify forces. Either they can multiply force, the one which is here, this can multiply the force. You apply a small amount of force over here and you get a magnified force which is applied over here, right? So this is magnifying, and it is as well as transmitting. It is transmitting from this part of the lever to this part, right? So it is transmitting. It either or, okay? So both of them can be there or just one of them can be there. Consist of multi-force member. Multi-force member, why? Let us say you consider just one of the element. If you see this, okay, yeah, let me draw it in an isolated way. Okay, so you have one force that is here, another force which is coming here, that is reaction force, and it is applied by a force which is here, right? So you have multiple force on the same member, right? But over here in this cycle, if you take any one of the element, you will see it has a member which has just two forces, both at the ends. Okay, so this is how they are different. We'll take up almost four lectures to do this. We'll take up almost four lectures to do this, plus one we'll have a tutorial class when we'll explicitly be doing different types of numericals based on this. These, okay. Parallelly, we'll keep on doing. We'll do a bit of theory. We'll do another numerical one by one. We'll tackle that thing. But explicitly, one class will be there for doubt clearing and attempting to different numericals. Okay, so that will be plus 01 or maybe another 01 we'll have. Maybe total 6 class we'll do this. Okay, we'll see as it goes. Okay, so this is what and this is how I have planned to take this forward. Okay, so structural analysis, objective of our analysis, what we want to do with all these three are to determine the internal forces. Mind it, this is not the same as we did in our earlier module. These are internal forces. That means if it is a beam, I want to see how much is the tensile load or a compressive load that is acting on this member. So any force that gets within this, it is not that what force this applies to an external member, okay, or what force that comes on it due to that. Okay, so those are not the concern of this module. So we'll see internal forces only in the members. Okay, reaction forces at the supports of the structure. If it is a structure, it is loaded over here. Okay, So if it is a structure, so we'll see how much is the internal forces on these beams, okay, individual elements, as well as what force that is coming on these supports, okay. So this is what we are going to analyze, and design of structure, and second, selection of load bearing members. We can do some modification based on that, okay. So that is the objective basically. These are the two things that we are going to find out, that is internal forces and reaction forces at the supports. Based on this, we want to do some selection on the load bearing member, okay, and some structure change if we can do. We can if we see this structure is not good enough, some overload is coming on one of the members, we can try changing that and see a new, analyze the new structure iteratively one by one, and we see if it is still under overload or it has crossed that limit, okay, within that limit, okay. So that is what we will see. Method of analysis will be, will identify statically determinate structure, will use statical method to determine these internal as well as external forces, right. So identifying that needs, what it needs, the structure itself should be statically determinate. We'll precisely define what is this, what it means, okay, when it is statically determinate or it is indeterminate. We'll see that in more detail. We can dismantle and draw free body diagram. This you are very much expert in already, okay. We'll see your expertise further when we have a complex structure like this, okay, maybe in 2D or a 3D, okay, we'll see that. Free body diagram of individual member. So this is our approach we'll follow, okay. Calculate forces using static equilibrium condition. Static equilibrium condition only we'll use to find out this. Done? Okay, so this is how we'll go for it. Now, truss. We'll first start with a truss. And more specifically, we are going to tackle only plane stress right now. Okay, so a framework composed of members joined at their ends to form a rigid structure. Okay, a framework composed of members, independent small members will be there. They are joined at the ends to form a rigid structure. Got it? They can be joined using rivets. Rivets, if you know, have you seen a riveted structure? Yes. Yes. One more. Very good. So Eiffel Tower is there. Do you know what is Havra Bridge? First bridge that is there on with. Yes. So you see, this is how we perceive, like we have Havra Bridge, I told you 5 hours from here, then you recall your Eiffel Tower, no? So anyway, I don't have personal problem with the Eiffel Tower, but you should see just next to you, you should have an habit of seeing what is near to you. Okay, welded structure, any example? Welded structure, your cycle frame. Your cycle frame is a welded structure, maybe your table is a welded structure, or your chair sometimes, okay. Yes, your gate, your grill, right. So anyway, so gusset plates, two overlapping plates, they are joined together, yes. And then you have bolts, you have pins, you have many other ways by which you can connect two members together. These are few of the approaches to it. Designed to support load. These truss, why are they there? They are designed to support loads. That's it. They are not supposed to transmit any motion, transmit any force, right? So it is not machine, okay? And because it is truss, okay, you will have each and every member which are there will be having forces only at the ends, okay, and only two forces which will be there. Okay, so we'll see how it goes. So let us say this is how your small garage may look like, or an industry floor, soft floor may look like. It can be just one of the frame we are interested in. All frame are almost similar. Okay. So one of the structure that I am going to analyze, and this one is a planar one. Okay. So this one is a planar one. So this is a plane truss. A truss, whole of the member, all the members will lie in a plane. Okay. On that particular plane, and we'll see. Based on the forces that is coming on it, we'll analyze what are the individual member forces, internal forces, and what could be the reaction force that should come over here. So plane truss will deal any one of the plane, right? So yes, what do you want to share someone else? Don't try your stunts here, okay? So try to be with me, okay? So anyway, so now what I'll do, this diverts me a lot, some disturbance comes. Okay, so plane truss will be composed of rigid members that lie in a single plane. As I have said, it is just one plane, and you have multiple members which are there. Force on the members always lie along the direction of the line connecting the two joints. If there are two joints, okay, one joint, second joint, so your member will lie exactly on the line that connects these two joints. Okay, your member is not something like this. Okay, it is not something like this. All members are straight members, right? So they lie along the direction of line connecting the two joints. Width and the thickness of each member. Width and the thickness of each member is negligible as compared to the size of the structure. Okay, as compared to the size of the structure or individual length of this structure. So L by D ratio, the slenderness ratio is very, very small. Okay. Very, very large, sorry. So length will be very high as compared to its diameter or thickness. Okay, so that is there. So now a simple truss will be composed of basic elements. Mostly triangles are preferred. Triangular frame, they are rigid. Why they are rigid? They are non-collapsible also. You cannot collapse. Once it is a triangle which is formed, if the links are not bending, you assume these are all rigid links, it is a rigid structure as such. Okay, it cannot collapse. I'll show you an example of collapsible structure if it is something like parallelogram. Okay, if you apply a force like this, it can go something like this, distort. Okay, is it not? So it is collapsible, whereas this cannot do that. Okay, so that is the reason it is non-collapsible. Negligible deformation in shape due to strain in each member. That is the reason triangular shapes are preferred. Okay, so simple truss will be composed of basic elements, which is a triangle. Polygon truss with four or more members, they are not rigid in structure. They can be something like this. Okay, you see they are collapsible. If you apply force from here, so this can go out and it can get deformed, right? So in order to make it strengthened, you can add an additional element like this, so as to make it a rigid structure. Now it is a formation of two independent triangles, okay, two independent triangles, and both of which is now non-collapsible. Got it? So now it is much okay. And again, it is a simple truss because it is formed with a triangle. So more members can be added to make it rigid and stable. Okay, it makes it rigid and stable. Okay, so we'll move ahead. So plane truss, what are my basic assumptions? Members are two force members, either tensile or compressive, along the line connecting its end, straight line. Okay. Weight of any member is negligible. The member weight itself is very, very less, as compared to the whole structure way, okay, or whatever load it is supposed to carry, because you know truss is a system which is supposed to carry a load. It is meant to carry loads, right? So the load which is going, it is going to carry, each member load is very small as compared to the load that it is going to carry, okay. So force acting in it, weight may act at the joint, these weights may act at the joint, members they don't bend. This is an ideal situation when it cannot bend. Even if it is there, it is negligible, okay. Members, these are the members, okay. So any thing, these are the members, okay. The members, because you see, if I consider any one of them, how many force is coming on it? Either it is compressive or it is tensile, and those are coming only through the joints, and there are two joints which are which this is connecting, right? Got it? Very good. So external loads can only act at the joints, right? And no other place. In between this, there can be no load at all. Okay, it is not supposed to, it is not designed to do that. Okay, welded, riveted joint or pin joint, if the member center lines are concurrent. If it is concurrent, let's say you have one member, you have another member. So this can be this member can be over here, you can have a welded, it can be riveted, or it can be a pin joint. We'll see different type of joint and type of constraint that it applies to the system. Okay, we'll see different types of joint just the next few slides. Okay, so they can be concurrent, right? Okay, their member center lines are concurrent. Okay, this way. See, weight can act only over here. It should not come at the member. Got it? If at all you have any external load that is coming, it will come only at the joints. Got it? Very good. Okay. So, large truss, for a large truss, one of the end is supported over roller or rocker. So what is meant by a roller? If at all you know, if it is a long thing, okay, it has its own thermal expansion. Let's say it is pinned over here. Pinned means it is jointed with this. Another end is normally supported over a roller. Why? Because of heat, temperature, thermal expansion can be there in this. Okay. So this roller allows it to roll and extend further. So that in high temperature, it, this much is the expansion and it rolls on it. Got it? If you fix it here also, a bulging can happen. Is it not? Yes, very good. So, this accommodates any deformation due to temperature changes. Yes, please come clearly. See, what I'll come to different type of joint, but for time sake I'll just tell you, this is a roller, okay. You have a beam, okay, that can expand, okay. If it expands, what will happen? It can bulge in between. If it is pinned over here, if it expands, it can go this way, right? So what will happen if it expands and you have a roller which can rotate this? So it can simply roll over that without having any bulge. Right, so you got it, very good. So this is how it is, okay. So that is the reason, if one end is pinned, other end has to be on the roller so that any thermal expansion can be taken care of, right? And to avoid making it statically indeterminate, okay, that also makes this statically indeterminate. We cannot analyze the system in that case. We'll see how it happens. But that is not the only objective. Basic first one is the actual thing that is there. Okay. Next one is the effect of that. It also makes it statically determinate. Okay. So next, width and the thickness of each member is negligible. as compared to its length. As I have said, width, that means this will be very small, width will be very small or negligible as compared to the total length, right? And you see, this is our type of roller. This is a roller, that means you have a pin joint, it is fixed here, but other end you have something like this, you have rollers, okay, so that it can roll on it. So if this is there, it goes like this, got it? So loads can act, we'll discuss that statically, indeterminate and determinate, very very much in detail today itself, don't worry. Okay, we'll come to that. Yes, अभी अभी बताया ना, थर्मल एक्सपेंशन होगा तो क्या होगा, इफ इट इज अ वेरी लॉन्ग ब्रिज एंड इट एक्सपेंड्स ड्यू टू टेम्परेचर इन समर, व्हाट विल हैपन? यू गॉट द आंसर? द वे यू माइट हैव रेड रेलवे लाइंस, नो दे आर कनेक्टेड विद द गैप, इफ यू रिमेंबर हाई स्कूल फिजिक्स, इट इज एज सिंपल एज दैट, सेम थिंग जस्ट लाइक दैट. ओके, सो इफ यू हैव अ रोलर, इट अलाउज दैट. Okay, be very very attentive, okay, and always be with your physics, don't leave it back. थिकनेस को पतला रखते नहीं है बेटा, देखो ऐसा है, एक्चुअली सी दिस थिकनेस नो, इट इज लाइक दैट बिकॉज दीज ब्रिजेस आर वेरी वेरी बिग, इफ यू टेक यूज थिकनेस रॉड्स, rods itself will have a havoc weight, is it not? If that itself is of 20-25 ton and a truck also is going to, that it is going to support is of 25 tons, so you can imagine you are already carrying thousands of trucks. Yes. Got it? So these are some of the basic physics thing, don't forget your physics, you will come back to this. So let us see different types of supports that can be there. Okay. Yes. Forget assignments now. Forget assignments now. We'll come back to that. Yes. After this slide, if you still have query, you come back to that. Okay. I think this has answer to all your queries. Many of your earlier queries also. Okay. So let me finish first two slides. So this is how a roller look like. Got it? This one. So what this can do, any movement, any thermal expansion from here, this roller can rotate, right? Roll over that and it can go this way. Got it? So it can take up any thermal expansion. Okay? Okay, let us say you have a bridge. This end is fixed. Okay? Other end is on the roller. So any load, if it comes and it gets something like this, so that also needs some degree of freedom over here. So this roller will also allow that. Okay. So it can go this way. Got it? So it can roll and it can allow that motion. So that is what is something like rocker. Have you seen a chair which can swing? Right? Yes. So it has a round bottom flask. If you remember, it can roll on that. Okay, so it has something, a swing, no, child cradle, sometimes it ends with something like this, so that it can roll on this. Even if it is not a complete wheel, it can be just part of the wheel, okay, which is a bigger wheel. Got it? So what this is called, this is known as rocker. It is known as rocker. Idea is same. Okay. Or a frictionless surface, this is not possible. This is an ideal thing, that you have a metal which is in touch with the ground and there is no friction over here. It is not possible. This is an ideal scenario. Or maybe in small machines you can find this. Okay. So in all these cases, as because it is free to move in all the direction except downward direction, it cannot move in this direction, so it can only have a force which is perpendicular to that surface with which it is in contact, right? So, because it has just one degree of freedom which is constrained, so it can have just one force with known direction, that is in the line of action. So, number of unknowns are 1. So, you got me which direction we are proceeding. So, this member, this type of any support, this is a type of roller bearing, okay, a roller bearing, okay. So, this can only have a normal reaction which is perpendicular to the surface on which it is rolling. Got it? So, there is only one force which is unknown. Got it? Okay, let us see a second scenario. When you have a link which is connected using a short cable or a short link, okay, both are equivalent. Only thing, a cable cannot take a compressive load, only tensile load it can take, whereas a link can take compressive as well as tensile load. Got it? So, this is a short difference between these two, but yes, you have just one unknown, and that is this direction. You have just one unknown, only one force that will act, and that will act in this direction. Or later on, by evaluating, you may find it can be in this direction also if it is a link. Okay. So, this is a case when force with known line of action. Line of action is already given. How you know that? Because you know the geometry of this short cable or this link. Okay, how it is topology, how it is connected, how those two bodies are connected. Over here, you already know the direction because you know the surface on which it is supported. So, reaction force will be only along this. Got it? So, these are all 1 degrees of freedom systems. Okay, so one force it will get. Next, what is this? What is this? This is a cylinder. A cylinder is pinned with a link. Okay, so what this cylinder is doing, it is something like a sleeve. Okay, so it can only move on this. So this sleeve can only move along this rod, which is this. Is it not? Or if it is a slotted link, you have a pin over here, so it can move only within that slot from here to here. Okay, so both of these are known as collar on frictionless rod or frictionless pin in a slot. Okay, in both the condition, how it is getting supported? It is getting supported on the rod itself. So, it will see a force which is something like this. Or direction may be different. It depends whether you are having a tensile or a compressive force in this member. Okay. So, you can have this force like this or this. Equally good. Similar to this, even in this, you have to have a force which is normal to this direction, perpendicular to this. Got it? So, force with known line of action. So, if this is your link which is supported on this linear thing, okay, so perpendicular to that link, linear support, you will get the reaction force. 1 degree of freedom. Okay, number of unknowns, 1. Got it? Very, very simple. Coming to next, frictionless pin on hinge. So, you got the idea, you try to build up yourself, okay, don't just see what I am showing you, okay, build up yourself, okay. So, what you see, places where you are constraining any motion, that is the direction of reaction force. Where I am constraining, I am not allowing it to move in this two direction, okay, so force has to be in this direction, is it not? That is why you have force in this. Look this carefully, you are allowed to move only in this slot. That means you are restricting any motion in this direction. So, you will get force in this direction. So, wherever there is restriction, there is force. Okay. So, analyze this again, a frictionless pin on hinge. If it is a pin on a hinge or a hinge, okay, or a rough surface on which you can just roll, okay. So, force of unknown direction may come. In this case, you will see a reaction force, a force of unknown direction, and that can be two directions. If it is pinned, you can have force because it is not allowing any motion in this direction as well as this direction. So, you will have forces in both the directions. Okay. So, you will have two direction forces. Both the direction you will see force. Okay. It is restricting two motions. Okay. So, that is the reason it will have two unknowns. Okay. Over here also, because it is rough, it is not allowing motion along this, it is not allowing motion along. Had it been a frictionless surface, this will go, only this will remain. But because it is having friction over here, it will have forces in both the directions. Got it? So, number of restriction, number of force, as simple as that. With this two example, it is very, very clear. Now, let us see another one. This is known as a fixed support. Fixed means it is not allowing any motion. X, Y, because I am talking about only planar system now. So, what all things it is restricting? It is not allowed to move in both the direction. It is not allowed to rotate as well. So, number of unknowns, Fx, Fy and Mz. About Z. Okay, so that is also restricted. So you will see one moment and two forces, right? Force and couple. So that is total three unknowns you will see. Now I think you started getting the thing. Okay, right. The what we have felt little difficulty in understanding our earlier assignments, this should clarify it in much detail with figure. Okay, I think this is quite easy. Now let us see some statically indeterminate structure. Why it is so important? Because what we think, you put up any load and any, if the system is defined, well defined, it is solvable as well. We should be able to find out all the forces and reactions and internal forces. It is not always true. Okay, condition for that is equation of static equilibrium are insufficient for determining the internal forces and moment. When this can happen, simultaneously equation have no unique solution. Number of unknowns are more than number of equations. This is quite easy. If you have done simultaneous equations, you know that already. Such systems are known as hyperstatic system. Hyperstatic system with redundant supports. Over constrained system. So, these are the situations when this can happen. We'll see by example again what is redundant support, what is over constrained system. Okay, we'll see that. And let us, yes, I'll tell you, I'll give you example, don't worry. Okay, just, yes. Just a sec, hold it. What I told, we are going to analyze simple truss. Simple truss are planar truss. So, I will discuss only thing in everything in a plane. I don't allow those motion, I don't define my system like that. My system is entirely lying in a plane. Okay, so that is the reason. Now you got it? Yes, you are true. If it is a 3D system, those moments and those forces will also come. But as long as it is planar, I will see only the forces which are lying on this plane. Moment which is lying perpendicular to the plane. Done. Got it? Very good. Okay. So, don't forget we are still on a truss now. And simple truss. Simple truss, it will lie always on a plane. So, plane, there are only three forces. One, two forces. Another force which is perpendicular to this is also there if it is fixed. But I am not considering any force in that direction. So, moment that can be generated even being on this plane is a moment which is perpendicular to this plane. Okay, that is mz. So fx, fy and mz. Got it? Okay, so let us come back to this. Let us come back to this and be awake, ask questions on that slide itself. Okay, otherwise we'll lose the tempo, we'll lose the continuity of this. So where were we? Let us come back to this once again. So we were examining what is the static indeterminate structure and what are the conditions when this can happen. What I saw, a system becomes indeterminate when it is having redundant number of supports, or it is over constrained. We'll see those by examples. Such systems are known as hyperstatic systems. So let us say you have a long bridge. You can support at one end, another end, bridge is done. You can move your trucks on this, right? You can move your trucks, your cars on this. But now, as because it was hanging little much, okay, what I did, I added one more support. Okay, done. Still it is same bridge, nothing changed. You added one more support, again it is same bridge. So this is having number of supports which is very much more that is required to define the system itself. So these are known as redundant supports. This system may have no solution at all. In that case, you may not be able to find out reactions for all the supports. Okay, you may not be able to do using statical techniques. There are techniques to solve this as well, but the way we are following, we won't be able to solve this type of system, and these systems are known as statically indeterminate system. Okay, again, let me have another system. Okay, let me have another system to define what is over constrained system. Okay, to define what is over constrained. Okay, so let us see, you have a wall which is having a cantilever. Okay, this is permanently fixed here. This system is fully constrained, fully defined, done. Okay, it is solvable, but as soon as you put another wall and you have fixed it again on the other end, it is unnecessarily trying to constrain the system and support the system, right? Now it is very, very difficult to find out the reactions at the supports. Okay, so it becomes very, very difficult. There are methods, but not through static methods you can solve this. Again, it is statically indeterminate system. So these are some of the way why it is so, we'll see that later. But yes, in these systems what happened, it formed number of unknowns which is greater than number of equations that can be generated with the given system. Okay, so number of unknowns are more than number of equations. So this is the reason behind why we are unable to solve this. Okay, so we have just seen. So let us see, you have an example truss which is given like this. Okay, you have one support which is over here. It has a vertical force acting at A, vertical force B, vertical force C. These are the three reactions which you should see. There is one load that is coming on top of it. Mass of the beam itself I am neglecting, as I have said, these are negligible forces. External force are only to be taken, because this is something very, very big. This bridge is supposed to carry more load than its own members. Okay, so that is why that load is always negligible for us. Okay, to make things very, very simple. Okay, mechanical guys will see complex systems also in their later semester, which is known as a strength of materials. Okay, you will solve this type of problem when you have masses for this also. You will have fixed supports at both ends also, maybe you will see and you will solve them also. But for now, these are plain trusses, these are massless, and it should be non-solvable. We'll see that why it is. See, summation of horizontal force should be equal to zero, summation of vertical force should be equal to zero. If I add all the vertical forces, so VA minus F plus VB plus VC is equal to 0. that is sum of vertical force which is equal to 0. Moment at any point, let us say if it is at about A, that should also be equal to 0. So, F into this distance, that is A which is given, okay. So, A is given, F into A minus VB into A plus B, got it, minus VC into A plus B plus C, okay. So, that is sum of all the moments should be equal to 0. So, you have two equations and number of equations which are implicit here are F means F here is the implicit equation. You just count number of equations which are there, number of unknowns which are there. Number of unknowns are VA, VB, VC and over here you have two forces because it is pin joint. You have this and this. Four unknowns. Okay. So, you have this also. The number of unknowns are four. So, that is why it is statically indeterminate. What goes next is by removing one of the support. Let us say I have removed this one. Okay. Now, can I solve it? This will make it solvable. You see how? Again, just by considering the moment, you see what happened? F into A. Clockwise should be equal to VC into A plus B plus C, correct? Okay, and that is quickly giving you VC. Now, if you know VC, so VA plus VC should be equal to F, that is force balance. Okay, VA plus VC should be equal to F. F is known, VC is known from here, so VA is also known. So, this is how you can quickly solve your system. It became solvable just by removing the redundant support because this A and C supports are quite good enough to define the system, it is done. Okay, so there is no redundant support and system is not over constrained also. Had it been a fixed support, okay, is it solvable? It becomes no. It is over constrained. Okay, it is not allowing any system to move in this direction. It is fully constrained. Okay, so you have to leave room for some motion. Okay, so that way it becomes not solvable. Some other equation will also put in. Some other unknown will come. Okay, so that is why it is unsolvable. So anyway, so there is a thumb rule to do that. There are standard formulas to find out if it is a complex system, not as simple as this one. Okay, that says 2j plus m, 2j should be equal to m plus r. What is j? J is number of joints, m is number of members, r is number of reactions. Okay, so we'll see by example again. Okay, so this is a system. This is a system which is having two triangles which are clubbed together, ABD and BD. See, done. So, count number of joints. So, A, D, C and B, four joints. Number of members, 1, 2, 3, 4. Okay. This hole is one member. Okay. This hole is one member. It is welded over here. It is not a pinned joint. You see, over here it is pinned. Okay, just a sec. I'll wipe it off so that you can see the question clearly. How many members does it have? Although it is jointed here, okay, but it is welded here. This AC is a single member. Okay, AC is a single member. So, 1, 2, 3 and 4. This we have split it to that. Okay, so that is why it is counted as, although it is welded over here, okay. So, we count it as two members. So, 1, 2, 3, 4 and 5. Okay, 5 members. Number of reactions you count. Why it is 4? Number of reaction is 4. Yes, because you come back to this now. For pin joint, where is my pin joint? pin joint, I didn't tell you. No, it is not here. So I'll tell you here now. Okay, so if it is a pin joint like this, that means it has a pivot over here, whereas this end is fixed. So any member that comes here is free to rotate, okay, but it cannot make any translatory motion in these two directions. So because it is restricted in these two directions, it will have force 1 and force 2, that is Fx and Fy you will see, but there won't be any moment because it is free to rotate. Okay, so that is what is a pin joint. It is like a pin. So you see a pin joint here, a pin joint here. So you have four reactions, two over here, two over here. Then four reactions, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5 members, joints, 1, 2, 3, 4, four joints. So you see, if you apply this formula, what happens? LHS left hand side is not equal to our right hand side. That means if this doesn't hold true, this is not statically determinate. You cannot solve this. Each pin joint has two reactions. You remember this. Okay. Coming to next. Now what I did, one end, I have just put a roller joint. This case, how many reactions will be there at this point? Just one reaction, that is normal to the ground. Over here it is 2. So it is 1 here, it is 2 here. Rest everything remains the same. So this becomes 3. In this case, 4, 2, 8, 5, 3, 8. Done. So it is both sides equal. Roller joint has just one reaction. This is just for the notes. So you see it holds true. So it is statically determinate. So this is one way you can find out if it is statically determinate or indeterminate. Mind it, it is statical methods. Okay, other methods, it is solvable. It is not always unsolvable. Okay. Okay, coming to little more complex example again. Okay. I have written it explicitly here. It is a truss girder railway bridge over Shivnath River. Okay, find out where it is. Okay, so this is our bridge again. It is from somewhere in India only. Okay, this is very simple, typical structure of any railway bridge if you have seen. So what I'll do, I'll see if it is solvable again or not. Okay, so you just take one of the simple truss system. Okay, one section only, not the other side of the bridge. Okay, so you count it. 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11, 12, 13, 14, 15 and 16. Very good. So it is 16. Okay. You got number of joint as 16. Number of members, if you will count, it is exactly equal to 29. Number of reactions. Okay. This over here is a roller. And other end, which is fixed to the ground, is always a fixed one. So you have two reactions over here and one over here. Okay, so it is 3. So you put them all together, you will see both sides becomes equal to 32. So this is a solvable system, statically determinate bridge. So adding any additional member would make it indeterminate. Adding additional member means if you add a cross member like this. Is it that? Can you do it? Or you can remove one of the member, it becomes a quadrilateral sometimes. Okay, so if you remove one of the member, it becomes that, and then it becomes unsolvable. Or you fix both the ends, it becomes unsolvable. So you can do either way. So normally you will see, yes. Reaction, I can draw it once again over here for its simplicity. Okay, so this end is a pin joint. This end is a pin joint. It is pivoted here. This end has got rollers. Okay, so if it is a roller, it can have just one reaction. And this side, because it is pin, it has two restrictions. because it is pinned, it cannot move along x and y direction. So it has two reaction force. So R1, R2, this is R3. Total 3. Got it?
Yes.
This number of temperature,
you try to count it. It is 29. I'll share this picture with you. Okay, you try to count. It is difficult because you can see the members which are on the other side of the bridge and getting confused. Okay, actually, it is very, very simple. You just count them. Okay, so I think this is the member. No, it is not missed. Yeah, he might be missing. Yes. So anyway, so I'll share you this picture raw. You just type Truss Girder Railway Bridge. This is very, very popular bridge over Shivnath River on Google picture. You can just find it out. Okay. And try to do one of the bridge which is next to your door somewhere. Okay. So you'll see if it is determinate or indeterminate. So we'll now go ahead and discuss few more additional notes about statically indeterminate truss, which is very, very important. Okay, because I have very little time remaining. Members may need to prevent collapsing. Sometimes, if the members are very, very long, you still need an additional member. Okay, sometimes you may require an additional member. If it is supported here, you may require an additional member. Because if it is very, very long, sometimes it can collapse. Okay, so in order to prevent that, you may add some members, although like member like this can be added. Okay, or to add some, let's say you have a pole light over here. In order to support that pole light, you added an additional member. Okay, so this could be having, this may have some additional function, or they are there to prevent collapsing of the structure. Okay. May be added to improve stability. Sometimes it is added to improve stability during construction and loading. Okay, during construction, few members are added. After it is fully constructed, it can be removed or it can be just left as it is. Okay, even after it is constructed, they left it there. Okay, and during construction and loading. Example, stiffening members are added to prevent buckling. Buckling means if it is a triangle, okay. Buckling means if you are having too much of compressive load in this, it can go something like this. That is what is buckling. Okay, it should not buckle. If it is so, what you do, you add two members here, you add two members here. So that will further stiffen this. But that doesn't play any role in defining this. Okay, so that becomes redundant links and it becomes unsolvable at that time. Okay, so if at all it is added, it can improve to stability while construction and loading. Stiffening members are added to prevent buckling on compression. Buckling on compression, you have one member, you have added a parallel member so as to make it stronger. Okay. Solvable but cannot be analyzed using equilibrium condition. They are also solvable, but not the way we are solving it in this chapter. Okay. Additional member supports which are not required are called redundant. Okay. Extra members are internal redundancy. Whatever extra members you add are known as internal redundancy. Extra supports if you add are called external redundancy. Extra supports are this and this was enough, but you added one. That is external redundancy. Extra links are internal redundancy. Okay. So with two extra supports and R is equal to 3 is an externally determinate system. Okay, externally determinate system. This we'll see again by example with two external supports. And R is equal to 3, if number of reactions becomes equal to 3 and you have two external supports, it becomes determinate. Maybe one example should be quite good enough. So M plus R is equal to 2J, it is statically determinate. M plus R greater than 2J is statically indeterminate internally. Internally, why? You have more number of members, okay, m plus r is less than 2j, means number of joints are more, okay, partially constrained system, unstable truss. Such systems are partially constrained and they are unstable, okay. Internal redundancy makes it internally indeterminate, okay. Internal redundancy, that means you have more number of members, okay. So it can cause any internal redundancy, okay. So these are some of the few things that you can see while you create your own truss of your own. See if these examples you can verify, okay. Redundant member may be added to align members during construction. Sometimes redundant members are added to align the member. Sometimes if you want to align well two structure, okay, together, you have added a member, okay, welded over here, then you actually filled up with this weld, okay. This weld deposition was done, these two were there just to support, later on this was not removed, okay. So this was there just to align this and this member, okay, and it was during construction it was done. May be required as a backup member in case of failure. Sometimes it is required in order to have a backup member. If one of the member fails, second one is there to take care of. Okay, the multiple supports can be there. So these are some of the reasons why you have redundant members. Okay, sometimes they add to functionality of something else, not of the bridge. As I have said, you may have a pole light which is attached or a wireless transmitter which is there at one end of the bridge, which is forming a part of the bridge, but that necessarily is not helping the bridge to take up the load. Okay, so that may cause it to be statically indeterminate, but there are methods to solve it as well. Most of the time we ignore them, okay, we solve without using them. Okay, I think that should be enough for today. Today's whole of the lecture was something from chapter 6 of Beer and Johnson. Okay, we'll go next with methods of analysis, different way how we can analyze the system. Okay, there are the method of joint, method of section. We'll see those methods from next class on.